20 years ago, I wrote a book comparing the way that Germany, both Germanies, the GDR and the Federal Republic, had dealt with memories of World War II, and I compared it to Japan. And I did it deliberately because I wanted to challenge the idea that there was some deep cultural difference between the two. But it was very interesting to find some responses to it. And I found especially that there was quite a lot of resistance to this idea of a direct comparison between Germany and Japan. Not in Japan. The Japanese rather like being compared to the Germans, the sort of the industrious, hard-working, clean Prussians of East Asia and so on. This is something that the Japanese find rather flattering. I found resistance among certain German liberals, left-wing Germans, who really rejected it because it reminded them too much of pre-war comparisons of Germany and the Asian samurai and all that kind of thing. And I bring this up because very often when people talk about the differences in which the Japanese have dealt with the history of World War II and the way that the Germans have dealt with it, and people tend to take the view that the Germans have been much more successful in facing their past, more honest and so on, than the Japanese, and they have often have cultural explanations for this. The Japanese, not being Christians or not having a Christian tradition, are supposed to be a culture of that doesn't feel guilt, it only feels, or doesn't feel sin, and so on. It only feels shame, because you can be socially shamed, but if you're guilty, that means that God is watching over your shoulder, even though nobody else has seen what you've done, and so on. There are these, and a lot of these comparisons go back to the famous book by Ruth Benedict, written during the war, by this American anthropologist who'd never actually been to Japan, but she was asked to write a book to explain the Japanese mind for American intelligence, the American intelligence community. And she came up with this comparison of guilt versus shame. Asians have guilt, have shame cultures, they're socially determined. People with Christian traditions have a guilt culture and a sense of sin. Now, I think this is actually nonsense. I mean, it's not complete nonsense, but I don't think it explains enough. My view, in short, is that the arguments about history and the way we face, use history and face the past and so on, has far less to do with cultural predispositions than it does with the problems of political legitimacy. And that history is very often a way to legitimize a political status quo. And if you look at the post-war history of both the Federal Republic of Germany and the DDR, you see this very clearly, that in both Germanies, the post-war order was set up in deliberate contrast and as a deliberate break with the Third Reich. In East Germany, of course, this was not officially problematic because that was the good Germany, they were the anti-fascists, they were communists, they had been on the right side and so on. They didn't really have to deal with national guilt. The Nazis, from their point of view, were all in the West, and so on. But in West Germany too, even though it is true that there were many people with a Nazi past who still played an important part in the establishment of the Federal Republic was clearly set up as a deliberate break from the Third Reich, in contrast to the Third Reich. And a certain consensus was reached in both Germanies on this, which was in some ways easier than it was in Japan. The analysis also held by the Allies, the Allied occupying powers in both Germanies after the war, was that the Third Reich in many ways was an aberration in German history. Yes, there are theories of from Luther to Hitler and all that. Nonetheless, you can clearly see that the Nazi regime, a criminal regime, came to power in 1933, destroyed much of the old order, and lost power because of defeat in 1945, and Germany could be slotted back in the case of the East to the communist world, in the case of the West to the Western world, into NATO, into a unified Europe, and so on. And perhaps rather perversely, the history of the Holocaust, which really only became an issue in the 1960s, in the 1950s people didn't pay very much attention to it, but made it easier to strengthen this consensus that everything about the new, but the post-war Germany had to be set up in complete contrast to the criminality of the Third Reich. Now in Japan, there is much less of a consensus about this, partly because the history of World War II and militarism in Japan was itself different from what happened in Germany. There was no Holocaust that people could basically agree upon that was an utterly criminal and grotesque enterprise. There were lots of murders committed by Japanese soldiers. There were massive civilian casualties. There was very widespread brutality. The Chinese in particular suffered horribly from Japanese military occupation. It was a very brutal and bloody war, but there was no systematic attempt for ideological reasons on the part of the Japanese government to exterminate an entire people. There was no Hitler, there was no Nazi party, there was the emperor, of course, whose role was complicated and still contested. But in many ways, it was a more conventional war fought at least partly by one imperialist power against other imperial powers, especially in Southeast Asia. Japan was an imperial power fighting European imperial powers over their colonial possessions. Now, China, of course, is still to this day in Japan a more painful subject, because you cannot really argue, even a nationalist cannot really argue that the Japanese war in China was a war of liberation. It wasn't. But they could at least argue that in other parts of Asia. Now, because there was no Hitler and no Nazi party to blame what had gone wrong in Japan, Japanese militarism, to blame that on, the Allies had to find another analysis, another explanation for what had made Japan go so badly wrong and what should be done to change it. And the analysis was really very unlike Germany. It was that the whole culture of Japan was rotten, that the samurai tradition, feudalism as it was called, the emperor tradition and so on and so forth, that these were all deeply rooted cultural problems that had to be seriously reformed. And so unlike Germany, which if you could purge the Nazi influence, if you could purge Germany from Nazism, Germany would once again become a civilized European country with the tradition of Goethe and Mozart and so on. In Japan, you really had to transform the entire society, its education system, its constitution, the role of the emperor, and so on. And hence the post-war order in Japan was a much more radical transformation in some ways than was true in Germany. And unlike Germany, which could revert to the Weimar period constitution, the Japanese were given a new constitution written by Americans with the famous Article 9 that made it illegal, unconstitutional for Japan to maintain its own armed forces, let alone to use military force in its foreign policy. This was meant to reform the sort of the alcoholic, as it were, the militarist tendencies in Japanese culture, that if Japan could become a pacifist country, that would transform the culture itself. Now, this was supported by a majority of the Japanese. They were so sick of war and militarism and being bossed around by soldiers and so on, that they were perfectly happy to become a pacifist country and never to have to deal with military affairs again. So the post-war order set in place by Japanese liberals, leftists, and Americans was not against the will of most Japanese, but it did encounter serious opposition beyond the fringe of Japan. There was a strong right-wing nationalist opposition to the post-war order as it was set up. It was considered to be illegitimate. The current Prime Minister, Abe, his grandfather, was a leading figure in this. He'd been arrested as a Class A war criminal. He was, in fact, the Albert Speer of the Japanese war. He was the Minister of the War Industry. He was in charge of slave labor and industry in Manchuria in the 1930s and so on. And he was released from prison before being indicted, before being prosecuted because of the Cold War and because people needed a lot of the old conservative elite to come back as staunch anti-communist allies in the Cold War. But Kishi Nobusuke, Abe's grandfather, was very much, he was an anti-communist, he was pro-American, he was a friend of Eisenhower, and he played golf with Richard Nixon and so on, but he remained convinced that the post-war order was not really legitimate, that Japan had been robbed of its sovereignty, and that the constitution needed to be revised, that a new form of patriotism needed to be promoted, and that the idea that Japan should become a constitutionally a pacifist power because of some deep guilt about the war was wrong. And the nationalists have argued that Japan fought a war like many other countries fight wars in their history. War is a terrible thing, but there was no particular reason for the Japanese to feel more guilty about their war than other nations. And again, to bring back that point I made earlier, there was no Holocaust for that certainly made the German case perhaps unique in history. There was no similar thing in Japan that could concentrate people behind the idea that it was a fundamentally guilty war. And the more that the left and the liberals in Japan defended pacifism by making the opposite case and saying we need to be pacifist because look what happened when the military were in charge. We have a deeply militarist tradition. We did terrible things during the war. In order for that not to happen again, we need this constitution. The more they made that argument, the more the right-wing nationalists had to stress that no, that's that's a liberal left lie, that's propaganda. The war was not particularly bad. A lot of these stories about atrocities are Chinese propaganda repeated by Japanese leftists. We need to be proud of ourselves again, and we need to revise our constitution. In other words, the historical discussion in Japan is not fundamentally about history. It's not a historischer Streit. It's not a debate between historians who have different interpretations of the past. It's a political argument about the constitution, about the legitimacy of the post-war order. And when Prime Minister Abe and his allies talk about revising the constitution, having a different attitude to the wartime past, their adversaries in this argument are not really other Asians. They're not the Chinese or the Koreans, even though they are certainly afraid of the rise of Chinese power. Their adversaries are Japanese liberal leftists. And they are accused in Japan of the so-called, of supporting the so-called Tokyo trial view of history, a masochistic view of history dictated by foreigners, by Americans, by Chinese, by Marxists and so on, which unjustly make the Japanese feel guilty about their war. But it's a constitutional argument, it's not really a historical one. I mean, it's not about finding the historical truth, it's an argument between political agendas. Now, if you look at other countries in Asia, China, you find similar problems with legitimacy, which have a strong influence on the way that history is remembered and discussed. Under Mao, the legitimacy of the Communist Party was a revolutionary one. It was based on Marxism, Leninism, and Mao Zedong thought. It was a class war, and the justification for the monopoly on power of the Communist Party was that of the dictatorship of the people under Mao. And it had very little to do, it had something to do, but it had very little to do with the immediate wartime past. It had something to do with it in the sense that the communists to this day in their propaganda like to stress the role played by communist guerrillas in their fight against the Japanese and so on, and they downplay the role of the nationalists under Chiang Kai-shek But in fact, it was the nationalists who did most of the fighting against the Japanese and not the communists. But under Mao, this was not really the main issue. Things like the Nanjing massacre, the comfort women and so on, this was not discussed under Mao. He didn't need to. It was really only after Mao died and China needed a new form of justification for the monopoly on power of the Communist Party, a new way to legitimize it, that it became an issue. Because Marxism, Leninism, and Mao Zedong thought was no longer sufficient. Very few people, even Communist Party members in China, believe in communism. They had to find something else. And in place of the communist dogma came a new form of nationalism, very much based on the idea of Chinese suffering in the last 100 years or so under foreign invasions. The Opium Wars, the Japanese occupation during the war and so on, and the justification for the monopoly on power of the Chinese Communist Party is that only the Communist Party can create the sufficient order and prosperity and power to make sure that China will never be humiliated by foreigners again. And this is why it was only really since Deng Xiaoping opened up Japan to business with the capitalist world that attention was paid to Japanese atrocities in Nanjing and other places, that you had patriotic sites, patriotic museums, monuments, and so on, that stress this nationalist message. Only under the communists can we make sure that something like this never happens again. And so again, when we read about how the Chinese see history so very differently from the Japanese, and that this is the source of the current tensions over islands and other things, in fact, it has a lot to do with domestic politics as well, with the legitimacy of the current political status quo. Korea, a similar story, similar, not the same. When Korea was annexed as part of the Japanese Empire in the beginning of the 20th century, a large part of the Korean elite, the educated elite, the old ruling class, collaborated with Japan. Assimilated even to some extent to Japanese culture, took Japanese names and so on. Later they were forced to, not in the beginning. Now some people did this out of fear, some people did it out of opportunism, some people did it out of genuine conviction that the Japanese colonial rule was the quickest way, and the most efficient way to modernize Korea. Like all colonial powers, the Japanese did quite a lot, or most colonial powers, perhaps the Belgians are a bit of an exception, did quite a lot in building universities, hospitals, railroads, and other things. So it's not a completely stupid idea of Koreans to collaborate with that. Nonetheless, after the war, this had a big influence on Korean politics, because and again, we see a family dynastic dynamic, just as you do in Japan. The daughter of the most influential military dictator in South Korea, Park Chung-hee, is the current prime minister of South Korea. Park Chung-hee had a Japanese name, I think it was Takahashi, I can't remember, was an officer in the Imperial Japanese Army. When he was in power, certainly did not make an issue of comfort women and Japanese atrocities and so on. He wanted Japan to assist South Korea to rebuild its economy, to build a strong industry and so on, and got on very well with conservatives like Kishi and others. It was only when the left, when the military dictatorship came to an end in the 1980s and more liberal governments came to power, that these old wounds suddenly were opened up again. And so in the 2000s, in 2005, under Roh Moo-hyun, a left-wing government, more or less left of center government in South Korea, suddenly decided to make an issue of going after the old collaborationist elite that had collaborated with the Japanese. So all these historical discussions really began then about not only about Japanese atrocities and comfort women and so on, but also what the role had been of the Korean elite. Now this was not primarily about history any more than the debates in China and Japan are primarily about history. It was a way for the left and the liberals to get at the conservative party, which was very much the party of the old elite that is now being led by the daughter of Park Chung-hee. Now, the reason the comfort women had become an issue is because under the old regime in South Korea, a deal had been made. The Japan agreed to pay a certain amount of money in reparations to South Korea, but it was government to government. None of that money went into any private pockets, didn't benefit any individual victims of Japanese rule. And after the military dictatorship, when South Korea democratized, individuals could suddenly have the freedom to press their claims, which is why it's become an issue relatively recently. So I think this explains also why, when it comes to islands, territorial disputes and so on in East Asia, Park Geun-hye, the daughter of Park Chung-hee, has to adopt quite nationalistic rhetoric, because for political reasons, she has to distance herself from her father's legacy, from the legacy of the old elite that collaborated to a large extent with the Japanese. It may actually go against her instincts. Now, my point to conclude, therefore, is really that all these debates and tensions and so on have much less to do with real differences about historical interpretations. They don't really have anything to do with historians debating with historians. They're mostly to do with domestic politics and different attitudes to the post-war order, influenced by the Cold War and the end of the Cold War to some extent, than they do with any kind of comparable historical Streit. So the difference with Germany too, if you take Japan and Germany, is not primarily about culture. It's not primarily about popular views or anything like that. It has to do with the way that the post-war order was shaped. Germany was managed to, at least West Germany, embed itself in NATO, in Europe. It was reintegrated with its neighbors as a respectable European country. In recent years, we don't even particularly mind, and I speak as a Dutchman, when Germany does well in football, unlike in the 1970s and 80s when we much resented it. So Germany has made it, really, in that sense. The Japanese have not. They still live with the legacy of the war for all these political reasons. Now, the one thing, and I'll really finish with that, the one thing that stops these tensions from exploding in serious violence is the fact that the major player in East Asian security remains the United States. And that suited everybody for a long time. It suited the Japanese because they didn't have to do anything. They could depend on the United States for their security and focus their attention on their economy, which was suited the business elite in Japan. It suited the Japanese because they didn't want anything more to do with military affairs. It even suited the Chinese because they'd rather have the Americans there as a military guarantor of order than that the Japanese would take that role. And they are the only alternative to Pax Americana in East Asia. But there is an inherent problem in this arrangement, which I like to compare to the problems of late imperialism, which is that if an imperial power has been in power for a long time, they in some ways become indispensable. If they leave too quickly, and this is usually the argument against leaving by imperialists, they always say, well, yes, of course, in the future, India or any other country should be independent, but they're not ready yet. The problem, of course, they're never ready as long as the imperial power is in place. And if the imperial power leaves too soon, you do get often chaos and violence, as happened in India in 1947. But the longer they stay, the harder it is for people to actually to get ready to take charge of their own affairs in a responsible manner. And I think that this is the problem of Pax Americana in East Asia today, that yes, if they were to leave tomorrow, tensions between a frightened Japan and China in the first place, but it would include Southeast Asia and Korea too, could very well end up very badly. But the longer the Americans stay there, the harder they make it for the Japanese and the Chinese and the Koreans and others to find their own accommodations and their own way of living with one another and so on. Now, I don't have an answer to this problem, but it's a problem that's often overlooked, because I think people, when they get used to a status quo, they tend to want to stick with it because it's the devil they know. And it's, of course, a problem that is not strange to us Europeans, because we're almost as dependent on American security as the Japanese are. And we are also used to this, playing the role of the permanent adolescent who kicks the big American father in the shins whenever it suits us, but still wants to be dependent on his power and largesse. And it's not good for Europe, it's not, in the long run, it's not good for Japan, but how this can be solved is perhaps a question that we can come back to in our discussion. So I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much.